Hey, grade 11s, welcome to Edu-ca-te. Today, let's talk about environmental resistance. This is something that most people find difficult, and to explain what is actually happening with that. So remember that in our previous video, we've talked about population size and the factors that that affect population size, such as immigration, natality, as well as all those factors. So today now we're gonna look at the causes of fluctuations in population size. So when you're saying that we have got fluctuations, it just means that the population is sort of decreasing, or it's sort of like fluctuating. We can just say it is slightly decreasing. Maybe let us say that in a population, let us just say there were two babies born. Okay, let's just say three babies born in 1 year. In the next year, you just see two babies only being born. In the next year, it'll only be one baby born, and then you see that the population is sort of fluctuating. It is slightly decreasing. So this is due to a factor known as the environmental resistance. So this is a population fluctuation. So now the causes that cause the populations to fluctuate or decrease, it is what environmental resistance. When we are talking about environmental resistance, we are trying to say that the environment is resisting the population. The word resistance, to those who do physical sciences, they know that when something is resisting, it means it is blocking something, right? So now saying that environmental resistance, it just means that the environment is blocking, or it's stopping the population from growing. How can an environment stop a population from growing? Like, how? So now this happens in three types of environmental resistances. We've got the carrying capacity, we've got density, the density dependent factors, we've got density independent factors. So we've got three types of environmental resistance. So which are three ways in which the environment can stop or decrease the population from growing? So now let us look at carrying capacity, the first one. So carrying capacity refers to the number of individuals an environment can support in a specific season. So we're talking about the number of individuals that an environment can accommodate. So do you remember that an environment is just the habitat or the space that the population is in? So if we have got a bunch of species in this space, remember that they have to feed on the resources that are in this environment. Remember that you cannot live without eating, right? So if we have got a bunch of animals, let's just say this is a population of animals, they have to do what? They have to feed from the food in the environment. And when the food is not enough, we would have said that the carrying capacity has been reached, right? So for example, if you have got let's just say in your house you have got only a small pot of food, it is enough for only two people. If there are three people in that house, will you all be able to eat? No. So it means that the carrying capacity is the number of individuals that that environment can support. So if your population will exceed a carrying capacity, meaning that if your population exceeds the number of individuals it can support, it means that there will not be enough resources to sustain the population. Remember that if the population needs resources, especially food. So if there is not enough food anymore, then what will happen? The population will not be able to be sustained, right? As I have said in that example, that if you just cook for two people in your house and then now five people come, the carrying capacity is actually the number of people that that pot can support, right? It can support two people because you cooked for two people. But then now there are five people, it means that the populations have exceeded the carrying capacity. So a carrying capacity is more like the number of individuals that each and every environment can support in a specific season. So this is just about carrying capacity. So when the population exceed the environmental carrying capacity, there will not be enough resources, meaning that there won't be enough food to sustain or for the population to eat. So now what will be the effect of that? This will cause the population to fall due to increased environmental resistance. So in saying that the environmental resistance is increased, it just means that the population has already reached a carrying capacity. Remember, the carrying capacity, let's just say in a population, this environment can support only 5 species, right? And then now a population has now exceeded 5. Maybe it is something like 10. Maybe these animals gave birth to 5 more, and then now they are 10 in the population. So do you notice that the carrying capacity, which is the number of individuals supported by this environment, was 5, but because now the population has exceeded and now they are 10, there are no longer enough resources to sustain the population, no longer enough resources for these animals, for these 10 animals to eat. So what will happen? The population will fall. Because if these animals do not eat, these 10 animals do not eat, let's just say 5 of them will not eat because the environment can only provide for 5, right? So the 5 that will not eat will die. So the population will decrease. The population will flow, will fall. The population will fluctuate. That's why we say carrying capacity is a cause of population fluctuation. We say that the population will decrease. It will fall because there are now more species than the environment can support. So the environment can support a maximum number of species depending on the resources that are present. Yes. So now we use that mathematically using a graph. This is how it looks like. So you can see that this is a graph of population size as a function of time in years. So what happens here, you can see that in this growth curve, the population increases with time, right? Let's just say here, after 20 years, the population is now 400 and then all of that. And then now when it reaches the carrying capacity, let us try to see what is the carrying capacity in this case. For this graph, the carrying capacity is this dotted line. You can see that the dotted line here is pointing to 1,000. The population size will be 1,000, meaning that this environment can carry up to 1,000 individuals. If there are more than 1,000 individuals, it means that this scenario will happen. We'll see how do we represent that using a graph. But then here you can see that this population increased here from somewhere here. Maybe this was 50. Maybe this was 50. And then it increased. And we know that the environment can only support 1,000 individuals. That's the population size, right? So we say this line is representing the carrying capacity. So this carrying capacity, is actually the number of individuals that this environment can support. For this graph, this environment can support 1,000. So you can see that here the population starts to fluctuate around the carrying capacity. You can see that the population, it is failing to do what? To grow. It is failing to increase because resources are no longer enough. Remember, when carrying capacity is reached, it means that the resources are being finished, so they are not enough to support the whole population. So what happens if it exceeds? So we're gonna look at this and say, if population exceeds the carrying capacity, this will happen. If population exceeds carrying capacity, so you can see that the carrying capacity for this one was 1,000, right? Meaning that the environment can support 1,000 species in that population. But then you can see now the population size here, this graph red, has exceeded 1,000. You can see that here where the graphs meet, this thing has exceeded, it has passed, or we can just say now there are more species than 1,000. Remember, the environment can only carry 1,000 species, or that's the size of the population, right? But you can see that here they've exceeded. They are now more than 1,000. What will happen? They will not exceed that much. They will just exceed for a time being, and then they'll start dying. That's why this curve is decreasing here, to show that the population size will decrease all the way up to zero, because they will die because they are no longer resources, right? Yes. So the carrying capacity in that way will decrease. So you can see that this black graph is sloping down, meaning that it is decreasing. Why is this graph decreasing? Remember, carrying capacity is the number of individuals that an environment can support. So a carrying capacity depends on the amount of resources that the environment has. If the environment, if the population size grows and reaches here, it means that all the resources will be exhausted. All the resources in that environment will be finished. So it means that if there are no longer more resources in the environment, the carrying capacity will decrease, meaning that it cannot support many individuals. Remember, carrying capacity, number of individuals an environment can support. So if the resources are finished, it will no longer be able to support as many as this 1,000. Remember, initially it was able to support 1,000. And then now the population has reached and exceeded, and the population now is now more than 1,000. So what will happen there? The carrying capacity will decrease, meaning that the environment will no longer be able to carry more species. So it won't be able to carry more individuals. So I hope this makes sense. Do you want to get more benefits from this channel? From only 20 rands per month, you too could become a member and get exclusive benefits and even private tutoring. Click join on our channel page to find out. And then now the second type of environmental resistance, we say those are density dependent factors. So there are many examples of density dependent factors. So when you say that we've got density dependent factors, it means that these are factors that depends on the population size. So factors depends on the population size. Factors depend on population size. So now what does this statement actually mean? It just means that if the population grows a lot and then there is a factor that affects the population because of the size, then the population is going to decrease. How does this mean? Okay, for example, let's just say if there is a disease in the population, this is the first example. Let us say now you've got let's just say you've got two populations here, two environments, two populations. So now these are 1, 2, 3. So here we only have got 3 species, right? And then on the other side, I will put more animals. Here are animals. All of these are animals, guys. So all of these are animals in a population. So do you notice that in this first population, population number one here, there are less species. And then in the second one, there are more species. So for density dependent factors, for example, if we take the disease in a population, if this was affected by a disease, like this animal was affected by a certain disease, the chances of that disease to be transmitted to another animal are less because there are less animals in that population. There are less species in that population. But if you were to take an animal here in this second population and then it was to be affected by a certain disease, because the population is dense, because the population size is big, density just means that the population size is big, right? So it means here there will be what? The disease will be easy to be transmitted to another species, and eventually the whole population will be affected, and then the population will start to fluctuate. So the density dependent factors are just those factors that have got a direct relationship to the size of the population in the area. It depends on the size of the population. If the population has got a greater size, you can answer this question this way. If they ask you how do density dependent factors affect population size, you are going to say that if the population size is big and then a density dependent factor such as a disease affects one species, that disease will be easy to spread to another species because there are many of them in this population. So they depend on the density. So the more species you have, the easier it is to do what? To spread the disease. You see? So there are many other factors such as territorial behavior, predation and competition, accumulation of waste, food, space, shelter, parasitism and disease. For example, if we take food here, let's just say this is an environment with enough food, these three will not fight for food at all, because in this first population we only have got three species. But if it increases, or if the population becomes denser, if the density of the population increases, meaning that if the population is now more, if there are more species in this population, what will happen? The food will not be enough for them, all right? So it's sort of like the same thing as carrying capacity. So it's a density dependent factor, because it depends on the size of the population. So if there are more species here in this population, then there will be less space as well. Space is another example. There will be less shelter, okay? If we were too many in the world, it would be very, very, very difficult to build houses in certain places. Just like people who stay at locations and gases, they see that it's very difficult to build another house at gas, because there are lots of houses, okay? They are dense houses, you see? But in rural areas, emakhaya, you can see that there's a lot of space. So space depends on the density of the population as well. So these are examples of density dependent factors. They do cause the population to fluctuate. Let us say, for example, another species comes in here into this population, and then it is full and it wants to build a house or its habitat here. It cannot build this habitat because there is no space. It is full already. So you can see that that will cause the population to fluctuate. And then the other one, the density independent factors. These factors will exert an influence on a population regardless of its size. So density independent factors just means that it does not, those factors do not depend on what? They do not depend on the population size. They can affect both small populations and big populations. It does not matter what is the population size. For example, if we take and just say back again, we've got a population with three species here. These are three animals in a population, for example. Then we've got another population with a lot of species here. Just say these are animals as I'm drawing them. These are animals inside a what? Inside a population. So now this is population one, this is population two. So what can we notice here? Population one is less dense. There is less density here. Less density. And then in that side, this is more dense. There is more density there. So there is a bigger density at the second population, because there are more. Density just refers to the number of the species in the population. So now when we are saying that there is less density, it means there are less species in the population. This side, there are more species in the population. So now what will happen now? In density independent factors, they do not care that this population is small. If those factors are affecting the population growth, it doesn't matter whether the population is small or is big. So for example, most of the times there are events in nature and they occur randomly. It does not matter that the population is dense or is not dense. For example, tsunamis, landslides, volcanic eruptions, failed fires, as well as floods. Let's say, for example, a lot of rain comes to both of these two populations, and then it washes away every habitat here, or maybe it kills some of the species here. It does not matter that here there were fewer species. No. The floods just affect. They do not, those factors do not depend on or on the density. They do not depend on the size of the population. Even if the population is big, even if the population is small, these factors will still affect. They are natural. Okay. So a very good example I can take. I can just say, let's say, even for us humans, let us just say floods were to come. Floods will affect all of us. It doesn't matter that you are rich, you are poor, you have this or you don't have this, because it does not depend on what you are. So in this case, same applies. Volcanic, if there was a volcano to erupt here, what will happen? These species will die. It doesn't matter that they are small or not. Even these ones can also die in the same way. So those factors, they do not depend at all on the density of them, of the species. They do not depend on whether we have got many species in the population or we have got less species. And by the way, if you do not understand the terms species and population, I strongly recommend you to watch our previous video, which we talked about population size. So please watch that video first so that you understand the term species and population. And thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe. Tell your friends to stay tuned.